Hello and welcome, everyone. Thanks so much for coming. I'm Luis Jaramillo, the Associate Chair of the School of Writing here at the New School for Public Engagement. For over 7 decades, the New School Writing Program has welcomed a vivid and diverse who's who of essential American poets, novelists, and essayists. Thanks for coming to tonight's event celebrating the release of Backward Round Sentences, a collection of the best work of Wolcott Gibbs, published by Bloomsbury Press. Gibbs wrote many pieces in many different genres for The New Yorker, fiction and nonfiction, profiles and parodies. He filed columns in The Talk of the Town and Notes and Comments. He covered books, movies, nightlife, and is probably best known for his work as a theater critic. I'm very pleased to introduce Tom Vinciguerra, the editor of Backward Round Sentences and our moderator tonight. He'll introduce our other participants. Tom has written over 150 pieces for The New York Times. He was deputy editor of The Week for 9 years and is the editor of Conversations with Elie Wiesel. Please welcome Tom Vinciguerra.
Well, the first paragraph of my remarks has just been stolen, but I'll say it anyway. Imagine a man who published more than 1 million words in The New Yorker by the time he was in his mid-30s. Who spent more than half his life at the magazine, who wrote Talk of the Town and Notes and Comment, as well as cutting profiles, funny casuals, pitch-perfect parodies, and fine short stories, who reviewed the press, books, nightlife, and movies, was theater critic for 18 years, and whose death made the front page of the Times. I'm speaking, of course, about Wolcott Gibbs. And tonight we're going to explore the man I call The New Yorker's forgotten genius. He's certainly forgotten, except for maybe one line in a 1936 parody of Time magazine. Spoofing its weirdly inverted narrative structure, Gibbs wrote, "Backward ran sentences until reeled the mind." That article, by the way, celebrates its 75th anniversary next week. As for the genius part, this is what his colleagues said about him. John Cheever called Gibbs one of The New Yorker's 4 or 5 ablest and most original contributors. Harold Ross, The New Yorker's founder, called him one of the best goddamn editors in the world. This from Brendan Gill. There was simply nothing on the magazine he couldn't do well. The poet Louise Bogan told him, "You probably use grammar more wittily than any man alive." And the ultimate accolade from P.G. Wodehouse. Referring to The New Yorker, he wrote, "Except for Wolcott Gibbs, it's the dullest bloody thing ever published." Gibbs died over 50 years ago, but he left a wonderful legacy. When E.B. White wrote his obituary, he recalled one of Gibbs's funniest casuals about the time he played Puck in a school version of A Midsummer Night's Dream. Gibbs's mother had made him a jester costume covered in tiny bells. The director told him, "I want you to be a little whirlwind." Gibbs did exactly that, bouncing and dancing all over the stage and drowning out all of the dialogue. "He was, in all truth, a whirlwind," wrote White, "and in these offices can still be heard the pure and irreplaceable sound of his wild bells." A few years ago, I visited Gibbs's daughter-in-law in Connecticut, and she still had that original Puck costume. One booty was missing, but I saw it, and I touched it, and I can tell you that almost 100 years after he first wore it, the bells still jingle, and so does his prose. And I'd like you to meet my fellow panelists. Kurt Anderson was a founding editor of Spy magazine, on which Gibbs was a profound influence. He's former editor-in-chief of New York magazine, a current contributor to Time, host of Studio 360, and the author of Turn of the Century and Heyday. Mark Singer has been a staff writer at The New Yorker since 1974, and has been almost as productive as Gibbs. He's written hundreds of talk stories, scores of profiles, and plenty of other pieces, many for the US Journal column. His collections have been published as Somewhere in America, Character Studies, and my personal favorite, Mr. Personality. What we're going to do now is each of us read in turn a few Gibbs samples that will give you an idea of his breadth and his depth. We're going to talk amongst ourselves for a bit, ask a few questions, and then we're going to open it up to you. So Kurt, if you'll take it away.
My pleasure. Thanks for coming, and I'm really happy to be here. I first read Wolcott Gibbs, the parody of Time Ease that Tom talked about, when I was a young writer in my 20s at Time Magazine. Even though what he was parodying had long since been dropped as the style of Time, I found it, the combination of reporting and humor, just so insanely good and modern, and indeed helped us when we were inventing Spy Magazine to be a kind of prototype where not many existed. Wolcott Gibbs is known for that piece more than anything else, and moreover, he's known as a really funny and mean guy, writer. He was funny and mean. He was many things, as Tom's description of the breadth of his work indicates. He was also very, among other things, wise and sensible. And in addition to funny and a little mean, I'm going to read some things that indicate those virtues. This piece was written in September 1939. I'm reading all Talk of the Town pieces. As we write this, 4 hours after the British Prime Minister declared war, it is still hard to understand what the headlines mean. Unless there's a miracle, 10 million more young men will die, very few of them, especially heroically or quickly. Millions of children will die, very few of whom had had time to form very strong or dangerous political opinions. Cities that rose proudly and slowly over the centuries will be ugly ruins between a morning and a night. The thought that built them, the thought of life, was turned off at 6 o'clock today with the speaking of a sentence in London. From now on, and for how long no man can know, there will be only the thought of death. The best minds in the world will now think continuously and cleverly of death, planning new and better ways to annihilate an army in the open field. The planes will be very useful this time. Planning ways to crush and stifle men in their impregnable shelters. It is a tribute to our ingenuity that no shelter these days remains impregnable very long. Planning bombs that set incendiary fires which can't be put out, a much more economical way of destroying a city than the old-fashioned one of just trying to blow it up. Planning death just as thoroughly and completely for old men and women and children as for the soldiers. This war will be quite impartial. It will play no favorites. The war against the flesh will be a terrible thing, and the war against the spirit will be terrible too. The hatred for a political idea turned almost imperceptibly into hatred for a race. The thought of killing turned adroitly from something shameful but necessary, if freedom is to survive, into an act beautiful and noble for its own sake. The mystical idea of God degraded into the likeness of an angry man, hating half the world. It is hard to understand or believe any of these things now on Sunday morning in New York. The city from our window seems unutterably safe. The high buildings strong and invulnerable against the sky. The streets we grew up in quiet and almost deserted on a holiday. The plane flying low over behind the RCA building toward the Hudson carries no threat to anyone. The children on their way to roller skate in the park don't even bother to look up at it. The voice on the radio speaks of a tennis game and not of war. The Australians lead 4-2, it says. We try to reconcile the cheerful and familiar details of our life with news that may well mean the end of all of them, but it is too soon. The 10 million men who will die are just an arbitrary figure, an estimate from another war. The children who will be starved or bombed belong to people we can never know. The bombs themselves will fall only on strange names on a map. It will be another day or perhaps another week before we realize fully the implications of what we've read this morning, before the horror is personal and real. As a matter of fact, though, there's no particular hurry. We'll all have plenty of time to get used to war. It's very likely that a good many of us will have the rest of our lives. An extraordinary thing to have written in 1939.
And considering that he thought that he would not be able to get out a weekly account of the Armageddon, as he called it when he inherited the department from E.B. White, you know, he did it masterfully.
And not only did he foresee what the war would bring, although he underestimated the deaths by about 80%, to show, again, his prescience, he wrote a piece in June of 41 in the Talk of the Town section that could easily be written today, but I think he did it first. The great paradox about this age of perfect communication, of course, is that nobody knows anything about what's going on. We ourselves read 6 newspapers every day, listen interminably to the radio, and spend a good deal of our time talking to industrious prophets who have just flown in from the warring cities and the capitals and the battlefronts. Our guess is that we know rather less about the state of the world than an ancestor of ours who lived in Connecticut and depended for his information on old copies of the Federalist delivered occasionally by a man on a horse. He got his news late and in fragments, but in the end, the picture in his mind was probably clear and sensible. We hear about everything the minute it happens in staggering detail, and generally speaking, it just adds up to balderdash. This is not only because the stage these days is too big for any man to comprehend, or because an event described by 95 eyewitnesses is apt to be less satisfactory than the same thing reported on by one, or even because the current government spokesmen are sometimes apt to be rather coy about their facts. It is caused mostly by our own frantic state of continual reception. We are too busy listening to hear anything in particular, too overwhelmed by the parts to see any outline of the whole. History, to be understood at all, should be absorbed a very little at a time, in solitude, and always a step or two behind the actual march of events. If we had the organization of this magazine to do over again, we would employ an elderly hermit to lie on a couch in a small, quiet room, perhaps eating an apple. He would read exactly one copy of the Times every month, and then, whenever our editorial way grew dark, we'd drop in for a minute and ask him what the hell was really up. Another piece, which I just, because again, it's brief and lovely and funny and apt to any age of the media, written in 1940. For more than 3 years, we have been watching a very bothersome and heroic struggle in the publishing world. Life magazine trying to figure out a way to print a picture of a living, breathing woman with absolutely no clothes on. That's right. The special problem of Life, of course, is that everything in it has to have that the air of a respectable, high-minded commentary on America. Life, that is, can't publish a picture of a woman undressed over the caption, "Woman Undressed." It has to say something. We are glad to be able to tell you that in their issue of February 12th, after years of frustration and 17 million angle shots that almost got there, but not quite, the editors have finally seen the answer. Like all truly great things, it was simple. They merely photographed a life class at the Yale Art School. This had Yale, it had art, it had class, it had America. It had everything, including no clothes on. It was Life's dream come true. A girl who had shucked, and no fooling, but had done it for her country. It was a tremendous relief to us, and a very interesting picture, too.
That entire paragraph, by the way, was recycled verbatim in Gibbs's one Broadway play, A Season in the Sun, 10 years later.
Is that right?
Yes, that's true.
I'm going to read a few of the last piece that Tom put in his book, which is a really interesting document. He wrote, he was an editor, as Tom said, at The New Yorker, as well as a writer. And this secret document, we think secret documents from inside organizations are only leaked these days. This one was leaked some years after its creation, I guess. It was written in 36 or 37 and entitled Theory and Practice of Editing New Yorker Articles. This was not, you know, to be published. This was literally a guide for new editors. I'm going to read maybe 8 of these 30 points. Number one. Writers always use too damn many adverbs. On one page recently, I found 11 modifying the verb said. He said morosely, violently, eloquently, so on. Editorial theory should probably be that a writer who can't make his context indicate the way his character is talking ought to be in another line of work. Anyway, it is impossible for a character to go through all these emotional states one after the other. Lon Chaney might be able to do it, but he is dead. Number two, and I happen to... The ones I'm reading, anyway, I agree with pretty much every one. Word said is okay. Efforts to avoid repetition by inserting grunted, snorted, etc. are waste motions and offend the pure in heart. Number four, funny names belong to the past or to whatever is left of Judge Magazine. Any character called Mrs. Middlebottom or Joe Zilch should be summarily changed to something else. This goes for animals, towns, the names of imaginary books, and many other things. Number 10, To quote Mr. Ross, the editor again, quote, "Nobody gives a damn about a writer or his problems except another writer. Pieces about authors, reporters, poets, etc. are to be discouraged in principle. Whenever possible, the protagonist should be arbitrarily transplanted to another line of business. When the reference is incidental and unnecessary, it should come out." Number 19, the more, as a matter of facts, howevers, for instances, etc., you can cut out, the nearer you are to the kingdom of heaven. Number 23, writers also have an affection for the tricky or vaguely comic last line. Quote, "Suddenly Mr. Holtzman felt tired. Has appeared on far too many pieces in the last 10 years. It is always a good idea to consider whether the last sentence of a piece is legitimate and necessary, or whether it is just an author showing off." Number 24, on the whole, we are hostile to puns. And finally, number 30, try to preserve an author's style if he is an author and has a style. Try to make dialogue sound like talk, not writing. That's my bit. Thank you.
Mark?
I'm going to read a bit first from a profile of Thomas Dewey. Is the New York State Thruway still called the Thomas
E. Dewey Thruway? The Thomas E. Dewey Thruway, yes.
And Dewey was, as famous as many of you I'm sure know, famously defeated Harry Truman in the 1948 presidential election.
And was compared to the bridegroom on top of a wedding cake by Alice Roosevelt Longworth. He was that small and well-dressed.
He was like another recent Republican presidential candidate, and when I read this lead, you will recognize him immediately, a prosecutor. And I won't be coy about it. As I was rereading this, I read it whenever I started reading Gibbs, which was in the mid-1970s when I got to the New Yorker and was not an author and had no style or voice and was looking for a way to find one if there was one inside, read Gibbs, among others, read Liebling. I mean, you can imagine the suspects, but they were the usual ones, but some not so obvious. And Gibbs was, you know, the exemplar, obviously, of what I later tried to do when I started writing profiles. This is a profile of Dewey, as I said. When I reread it, I thought of Rudy Giuliani, and every reference I have here to organized crime, if you can just insert 9/11 into that, it adds up. This is the lead. In a great many ways, this is 1940, by the way, this is when he's running for president not in 48. In a great many ways, Thomas Edmund Dewey is an impressive presidential candidate. He was born in a typical American town, Owosso, Michigan, population 14,496, and he came of sound American stock. The hero of Manila Bay was his grandfather's third cousin. In his virtuous youth, he belonged to the Boy Scouts, sang in the choir, and peddled the Saturday Evening Post, winning a bicycle. At one time, he spent the summer working as a hired hand on a farm, and at another, he learned to set type on his father's newspaper. He went to the local public schools and was never late or absent a day in his life. This is damning with faint praise, I think. After he was graduated from the University of Michigan and had taken his LLB at Columbia, he was admitted to the bar and presently emerged at the age of 33 as a fighting prosecutor and the terror of the underworld. Obviously, all this is in the most acceptable tradition, the saga of a more virile and melodious Coolidge, without the snobbish taint of Amherst or the sad comedy of the Electric Horse. A little dated, some of this. Fortunate as he was in his personal background, however, he was even more fortunate in the times that produced him. Whatever else it accomplished, Prohibition got the world ready for the coming of Dewey. The intense melodrama of the 20s accustomed people to the idea of an aristocracy of crime, to a superheated vision of America ruled by an outlaw nobility of vast and incalculable powers. Beer barons and vice lords were a dime a dozen. Almost every thug was at least a king. In New York, there were kings of vice, poultry, dope, fur, policy, and artichokes, to mention a few. And each of them commanded a band of desperados capable of dealing with the United States Marines. It was wonderful. Even more wonderful were the names that some of these monsters and their mates obligingly bore. In addition to the such celebrated figures as Lucky, Waxy, Dixie, Legs, and Lepke, there were Spasm Ison, Cokie Flo Brown, Stoned Face Peggy, Jenny the Factory, Crazy Moe, Abadabba, Gashouse Lil, Six Bits, and Blue Jaw Magoon. From almost the beginning of his political career, Dewey tangled with this demoniac royalty, and he made the most of it. If the voters were already inclined to believe that they were taking part in a moving picture, he did little to disillusion them. His private and public conversation always emphasized the menace of the underworld. Omnipresent, almost omnipotent, crouched for a leap. "What do you know about the Unione Siciliana?" he asked a startled interviewer. And when it turned out that the man knew almost nothing, he described the fate of a prominent writer who offered to sell Liberty, that was in a magazine, Liberty, a story about its machinations, and was shot down like a dog for his pains. "Never been in the papers," whispered the district attorney, rolling his eyes wildly. "No indictment. A terrific business. If you had seen men blanch as I have at its mere mention, you would know what terror it holds." He was no less alarming when addressing millions. "He has a Japanese butler," he said over the radio, referring to the king of something or other, "who serves him well." He has prosecuted a few cases in which he was unable to suggest that there were nameless forces at work, and this sometimes irritated his critics. "No matter if it was only rolling a lush," said one of them in his homely way, Dewey could always make it look wonderful on the record. I want to continue just with this physical description of Dewey, because this is really a tricky part of writing profiles, I felt. And you spend a lot of time with someone, and you really do find yourself one day paying no attention to what they're saying, but looking at them very carefully and trying to figure out what is it exactly about this face that one can capture in words. And Dewey was writing at a time when there were no photography also in the New Yorker, so you had to really be judicious and imaginative, I suppose. "Dewey has a jutting jaw, high cheekbones, a slightly bulbous nose, and thick eyebrows. His face, on the whole, has a compressed appearance, as though someone had squeezed his head in a vise." Years before Goodfellas.
It was Scorsese.
I think it was Casino. Casino.
Oh, God.
And my son in the back, who's watched it 60 times, just reminded me of Casino. "His suits are custom-made but uninteresting and always seem a little too tight for him. Although the Merchant Tailors and Designers Association of America chose him this year as one of the 25 best-dressed men in America. Altogether, smallish, neat, and dark, he looks like a Wall Street clerk on the way to work. Unlike the late and magnificent Harding, he is a hard man to imagine in a toga." And then this is just this last bit. "Dewey is also unfortunate in the fact that people too close to him are usually either entertained by his super cinema technique or else irritated by his proud, peculiar waves. One crisp hostess has said, you have to know Mr. Dewey very well in order to dislike him." And then I'm going to read, and this is like a line in this piece that I always just, these are scattered throughout Gibbs's writing. This is just one I picked on. "Dewey says he was a private practice as a lawyer for a while. Dewey says he was immensely successful in private practice, estimating the take at between $50,000 and $75,000 a year, a figure which even his best friends consider imaginative." 1940. So, most lawyers bill that an hour now, of course. So. Okay, this is a different Gibbs. This is Gibbs as parodist. And the two aspects of Gibbs' work that I most loved were the parodies. Kurt is going to let us hear some one of his greatest in a bit, and aren't you?
Maybe, if you
okay,
say so.
Okay. And the profile. So here is, the great rule of thumb in parodies is, of course, you should not have to be familiar with the thing being parodied to appreciate the parody. The New Yorker didn't take certain things for granted, so a lot of times when they published a parody, they would have a sort of explanatory subtitle to help the reader along. This is Death in the Rumble Seat. And with the usual apologies to Ernest Hemingway, who must be pretty sick of this sort of thing. And any of you familiar with Hemingway's book on bullfighting, Death in the Afternoon, will recognize this. Or Hemingway himself, if you know that style. Most people don't like the pedestrian part, and it is best not to look at that. Remember, this is Death in the Rumble Seat, okay? Most people don't like the pedestrian part, and it is best not to look at that if you can help it. But you can't help seeing them, long-legged and their faces white, and then the shock, and the car lifting up a little on one side. Then it is best to think of it as something very unimportant, but beautiful and necessary artistically. It is unimportant because the people who are pedestrian are not very important. And if they were not being cojito by automobiles, it would just be something else. And it is beautiful and necessary because without the possibility of somebody getting cojito, driving a car would be just like anything else. It would be like reading Thanatopsis, which is neither beautiful nor necessary, but hogwash. If you drive a car and you don't like the pedestrian part, then you are one of two kinds of people. Either you have very much vitality and you ought to do something about it, or else you are yellow and there is nothing to be done about it. If you don't know anything about driving cars, you are apt to think a driver is good just because he goes fast. This may be very exciting at first, but after... This may be very exciting at first, but afterwards there is a bad taste in the mouth and the feeling of dishonesty. I hope I get through this. Ann Bender, the American, drove as fast on the Merrick Road as anybody I have ever seen. But when cars came the other way, she always worked out of their terrain and over in the ditch so that you never had the hard, clean feeling of danger, but only bumping up and down in the ditch and sometimes hitting your head on the top of the car. Good drivers go fast too, but it is always down the middle of the road. So the cars coming in the other way are dominated and have to go in the ditch themselves. There are a great many ways of getting the effect of danger, such as staying in the middle of the road to the last minute and then swerving out of the pure line. But they are all tricks. And afterward, you know they were tricks. And there is nothing left but disgust. This is, the cook is a character that's interjected, as in Hemingway. I'm a little tired of cars, sir. Do you know any stories? I know a great many stories, but I'm not sure that they're suitable. The cook, the hell with that. Then I will tell you a story about God and Adam and naming the animals. You see, God was very tired after he got through making the world. He felt good about it, but he was tired. So he asked Adam if he'd mind thinking up names for the animals. What animals, Adam said. Those, God said. Do they have to have names, Adam said. You've got a name, haven't you, God said. I could see. The cook, how do you get into this? Some people always write in the first person, and if you do, it's very hard to write any other way, even when it doesn't altogether fit into the context. If you want to hear this story, don't keep interrupting. The cook, okay. I could see that Adam thought God was crazy, but he didn't say anything. He went over to where the animals were, and after a while, he came back with a list of names. Here you are, he said. God read the list and nodded. They're pretty good, he said. They're all pretty good except the last one. That's a good name, Adam said. What's the matter with it? What do you want to call it an elephant for, God said. Adam looked at God. It looks like an elephant to me, he said. The cook, well? That's all. The cook. It's a very strange story, sir. It is a strange world. And if a man and a woman love each other, that is strange too. And what is more, it always turns out badly. In the golden age of car driving, which is about 1910, the sense of impending disaster, which is a very lovely thing and almost non-existent, was kept alive in a number of ways. For one thing, there was always real glass in the windshield. So that if a driver didn't hit anything, he was very definitely and beautifully cojito. The tires weren't much good either, and often they blow out before you'd gone 10 miles. Really, the whole car was built that way. It was made not only so that it would precipitate accidents, but so then when the accidents came, it was honestly vulnerable, and it would fall apart, killing all the people with a passion that was very... killing all the people with a passion that was very fine to watch. Then they began building the cars so that they would go much faster, but the glass and tires were all made of so that if anything happened, it wasn't real danger, but only the false sense of it. You could do all kinds of things with new cars, but it was no good because it was all planned and advanced. Mickey Finn, the German, always worked very hard into the other car's terrain so that the two cars always seemed to be one. Driving that way, he often got the fender or the clicking where two cars touch each other in passing, because you knew that nothing was really at stake, it was just an empty classicism without any value left because the insecurity was all gone and there was nothing left but a kind of mechanical agility. It's the same way when any guard gets into its decadence. It's the same way about the SX, oh, about S, the S blank X, the cook. I like it very much better when you talk about S blank X, sir, and I wish you would do it more often. I have talked a lot about S blank X before, and now I thought I would talk about something else, the cook. I think that is very unfortunate, sir, because you are at your best with S blank X. But when you talk about automobiles, you are just a nuisance.
Mark, you've definitely brought a new appreciation of Hemingway to me. You really have. I'm going to finish up with just a couple of Gibbs's more pungent theater reviews, and I'm going to preface this by a paragraph that he wrote in the New York Herald Tribune explaining his attitude toward the theater, which was not very generous. The theater itself, on an opening night, isn't a very comforting place for a nervous man. The old faces, and some of them are getting very old indeed, he wrote this in 1950, have the effect of a recurring nightmare. The offstage conversation is loud and generally facetious, for there is hardly a first-nighter who doesn't fancy himself as a humorist. The air is almost always either too hot or too cold, and strongly charged with the scent of alcohol, perfume, and disinfectant. There is rarely an adequate place to dispose of a hat and coat, and again, there's the anxiety about getting a cab in the end, a doomed project since only the first 10 or 12 people leaving the theater are likely to be so accommodated, and there are those who, after years of experience, can run rings around an antelope. These are by no means all the physical discomforts attached to my career. There is, for instance, the matter of trying to make notes on a program in the dark, which are apt to seem to say, "Why she keep that goat in the attic?" on inspection the following morning. But they're probably enough. It has sometimes occurred to me that managements would be well advised to furnish each critic with a good stiff drink of something or other on his arrival at his seat, but I'm afraid this idea will never really take hold, the consensus among producers being that a writing man operates best in a state of faint uneasiness and melancholy. And for faint uneasiness and melancholy, I give you these examples of Gibbs's criticism. This is from a play called The Man Who Had All the Luck from December of 44, and you're not going to believe who wrote it. If the man who had all the luck held me in my seat for three interminable acts, it was largely out of incredulity, for in it Arthur Miller surely wrote one of the strangest plays of the decade. Since it is now deceased, a very brief synopsis should suffice. The first act was about a garage man who didn't know much about machinery. The second act was about a pitcher who was no good when there were men on bases, because he'd been trained privately by his father in the basement. The third act was about childbirth, and a mink farm where the mink were threatened with poisoning because there were silkworms in their fish. There was also some mention of a veteran of the First World War who got the Croix de Guerre when the boiler blew up in a whorehouse. A little shapeless, you might say. And this is an example of Gibbs being remarkably deft and having absolutely no tolerance for any sort of nonsense. From The Haven, this is a review of a play called The Haven from November of 46. A drama called The Haven opened and closed after a brief run last week. You're supposed to be polite about such operations, and I'm prepared to be as polite as the next. Dennis Hoey, Melville Cooper, Valerie Cossart, Viola Roach, and Ivan Simpson were in it. That's the end. And this is a real masterpiece, I think. Sing Till Tomorrow opened and closed in January of 1954. It was one of the management's very minor eccentricities that no curtain rose on Sing Till Tomorrow, a drama about a discontented druggist which was revealed last week at the Royale. The setting was already visible when early comers took their seats, and it remained so during the whole demented evening. If this maneuver was intended to suggest that the piece was not actually meant to be regarded as a play, I should say that it served its purpose. Because never in a career that has demanded my attendance at such unforgettable specimens as Grandma's Diary, A Red Rainbow, and Popsy, have I seen anything quite equal to it in moonstruck incoherence of plot, in horrid abuse of the English language, and in a style of acting strongly remindful of that attributed to the King and the Duke in Huckleberry Finn. Sing Till Tomorrow opened with a pale and furious young man standing in a beam of light. "This is my play," he said. "My father is in it. Evie's in it. I'm in it." I report these four sentences with such care because, as far as I was concerned, they were just about the last comprehensible remarks made that night. Words, of course, continued to pour across the footlights, but while an alert ear could identify them individually, they appeared to make little or no sense in combination. It was clear that the author is a powerful master of elegant variation. "I think I shall depart elsewhere," and deliriously tangled metaphor. "Your pestle is a striped candy bar crushed at the base of the pyramids." But beyond that, I could deduce almost nothing about the quality or content of his mind. The action wasn't especially helpful either. At one point, the druggist seemed to be upbraiding a companion for entering a cold storage bass in a fishing contest. At another, several characters stood at the forefront of the stage and pretended to cast bait out into the audience. At still another, a band of resolute cut-ups set a small jocular fire in the drugstore and extinguished it with punch. And throughout the play, the pharmacist addressed his wife as "son," an arch device that may be unique in the annals of the theater. The actors principally involved in this massacre were named John Marley, who played the producer Waltz in The Godfather, Michael Sheehan, and Eileen Ryan, Granny from Beverly Hillbillies, right? As I've said, their performances were somewhat lacking in polish, but I found it hard to contain my admiration for their memories. Anybody who could read, retain, and subsequently deliver the dialogue of Sing Till Tomorrow could, I think, readily do the same thing with a cookbook. There's also the chance, of course, that they were making it up as they went along. So just to step back a bit, I was first introduced to Gibbs when I read about him in the Guinness Book of World Records. It's a totally apocryphal story, but supposedly he delivered the shortest piece of theatrical criticism on record. There was a farce called Wham, and he delivered the single word review, "Ouch." I found no record of Wham on or off Broadway anywhere, but that was what made the first impression on me, and then I was introduced to backward ran sentences in a class at the journalism school, and I think that seems to have been where most people first find out about him. But Mark, you had said that you were drawn most readily to the parodies and the profiles. Does anything else come to mind?
Well, just the fact that I knew nothing about him, although I read about him. I had read Thurber's book on the New Yorker, so there was certainly stuff about that. I shouldn't say that. I was familiar with him, but he seemed a very poignant figure, basically, and I think that's absolutely true. I mean, you've pointed this out in your introduction here, and I don't know how shy people function in the world, and that was another thing that one knew about Gibbs. I'm not particularly shy myself, and especially as a reporter, when I was reading his profiles and I was thinking about writing them myself, I was trying to figure out how he actually reported, you know. And he had other people do a lot of his legwork.
He did. Turned out. He did.
That's what it was. So, for example, I think the Henry Luce profile was reported by St. Clair McKelway, largely.
And some assistance from John Bainbridge.
And John Bainbridge. By the way, John Bainbridge, since the name comes up again, more obscure than Gibbs, but was another writer who I really basically, you know, just devoured. He wrote a great book called The Super Americans about Texas. It was published in the 60s, and it was very prescient about Texas, and it basically had the theory that Texas is to America as America then was to Europe, that represented everything vulgar and supersized and you know, distasteful but fascinating in this country. And the analogy worked, probably. And Bainbridge wrote other wonderful books that I love.
About Reader's Digest, for instance.
He wrote The Little Wonder. And he wrote, I think, the book on Toots Shore. And I actually once made a pilgrimage a few years before he died to England. I was going there, and I went to see him, and he was living very quietly, sort of in Bath, England. And but he was one of those guys who you know, did this sort of stuff. And I think that he probably got his voice in the same way from Gibbs as reporting, and then having Gibbs rewrite it. Go ahead.
One of the things that when I discovered Backward ran the sentences that was so revelatory to me was that it was both a profile, a reported profile, and a parody of what was then this slightly absurd, highly compressed Time magazine ease. And to combine this full bore, full out parodistic thing, like the, you know, Hemingway piece that Mark read, with real reporting and real facts was just so thrilling to see done. And especially, and in my case, I discovered it when I was at Time magazine. When I started working at Time magazine, I was 26 years old. I'd never written for print journalism, so I'd written for my college humor magazine, so I knew how to do parodies, so I just parodied Time magazine and as best I could until an editor said, you know, you can, you know, we no longer have any house style here anymore. You can just write as if you're at the New Yorker. I said, okay, thanks. And then 10 years later, when I was at the New Yorker, the then editor of the New Yorker told me during my first months there, she said, I won't do an accent, so you won't know who it is. Just keep it, you know, quick and with high energy, like, you know, like a piece in Time magazine. So there's a time. Wolcott Gibbs has stalked me my entire career, I guess.
It's funny that it's ironic that Gibbs relied on legmen for so much of his work, because that was one of the things that
Luce
was
invented.
But it was also despised at Time that the correspondents would turn in material from the field, and the editors and writers would rewrite it as they saw fit.
But I doubt that the people who were doing Gibbs's reporting were resented.
Oh no! By no means.
It was very.
And I doubt that the people who did Gibbs's reporting resented him the way Time correspondents resented the guys in New York.
Oh no! I mean, among other things, Gibbs did not pour everything through a political filter to get it onto the page. No, by no means.
But you know that loose profile. You know, he just made stuff up too. You know, that was his argument was, hey, it's a parody. You know, people know that that's a parody, and so they know you're going to make stuff up.
Because Time got so many things wrong.
Right, and that was that.
And this was before the New Yorker was famous for getting everything right and having scrupulous fact checking, I guess. Right?
No.
Kurt, did you want to read an excerpt from the?
Read a little bit of it. Sure. Of what we're talking about here.
And again, literally, this the profile will be 75 years old next week. It was in the November 28th issue of the magazine, which came out on the 21st of 1936.
And again, as Mark mentioned, you know, the success of a parody is not having to know what it's parodying and still finding it funny. And again, it was long since. Time magazine had long since not sounded like this in the 1970s or 80s, even when I encountered it for the first time. I'll read from the beginning. The title is Time, .. Fortune, .. Life, .. Loose. Sad-eyed last month was nimble, middle-sized life president Clair Maxwell as he told news hawks of the sale of the 53-year-old gag mag to Time. For celebrated name alone, price? $85,000. Said he, life, ellipsis, introduced to the world the drawings, ellipsis, of such men as Charles Dana Gibson, the verses of, ellipsis, James Whitcomb Riley and Oliver Herford, such writers as John Kendrick Bangs. Beginning next month, the magazine Life will embark on a new venture entirely unrelated to the old. How unrelated to the world of the Gibson girl is this new venture might have been gathered at the time from a prospectus issued by enormous Apollo-faced C.D. Jackson of Time, Inc. Life, wrote he, will show us the man of the week, his body clothed and, if possible, nude. The motif begins. It will expose, quote, the loves, scandals, and personal affairs of the plain and fancy citizens and write around them a light, good-tempered, columnist review of these once private lives. 29,000 die-hard subscribers to Life, long accustomed to he-she jokes, many ignorant of King of England's once private life, Time, July 25th, will be comforted for the balance of their subscription periods by familiar, innocent jocosities of Judge. First issue of new publication went out last week to 250,000 readers, carried advertisements suggesting an annual revenue of $1,500,000, pictured Russian peasants in the nude, the love life of the Black Widow Spider, referred inevitably to Mrs. Ernest Simpson. Behind the latest, most incomprehensible Time enterprise, one word, looms, as usual, ambitious, gimlet-eyed, baby tycoon Henry Robinson Luce, co-founder of Time, promulgator of fortune, potent in associated radio and cinema ventures. And it goes on. I mean, of course, and just so we have it, because what would it be without not having the end? It's a very long piece. The end is... Whatever the facts in the matter, indicative of a loose consciousness of budding greatness, of responsibility to whole nation, was his report to Time's board of director on March 19th, 1936. Declaimed he, the expansion of your company has brought it to a point beyond which it will cease to be even a big small business and become a small big business. The problem of public relations also arises. Time, the weekly news magazine, has been and still is its own adequate apologist. Ditto fortune. But with a motion picture journal, a nightly radio broadcast, and with four magazines, the public interpretation of your company's alleged viewpoint or viewpoints must be taken with great seriousness. Certainly to be taken with seriousness is Luce at 38, his fellow men already informed up to his ears, the shadow of his enterprises long across the land, his future plans impossible to imagine, staggering to contemplate. Where it will all end knows God. Yeah. And, of course, they did do Time Marches On, too, so my Time Marches On style reading was appropriate.
When Luce was shown proofs of this profile before it went to press, he had a showdown with Harold Ross and St. Clair McKelway, Gibbs's colleague, with Ralph Ingersoll, who used to work for The New Yorker and who was, I think at that point, president of Time, Inc., and Luce was absolutely furious. Gibbs was hiding out somewhere in a bar. He didn't have to go. And he was irate. He practically threw Ross out the window. And one of the most memorable lines, a couple of memorable lines to come out of that, were when Luce said, "It is not true," as Gibbs had written, "that I don't have a sense of humor." And McKelway said, "I think that was the most humorless thing I ever heard in my life." And he said, "God damn it, Ross, this whole thing is..." He used to stammer. He said, "It's malicious." And Ross said, "You're right, I believe in malice." Yeah, a forethought, no less. I've got a semi-major question, one that I've been unable to satisfactorily answer. Why has Gibbs been forgotten in a way that White and Thurber and Liebling and so many other of his colleagues have not been?
Because everybody confuses him with
Alexander Wolcott. He would not appreciate the comparison.
I joke, but that's like a bit of it, I think, actually. What do you think?
Breaking it down, I would say that E.B. White is remembered because he didn't just write for adults. And so that is a name familiar to people. And Thurber was also, you know, popularized. I mean, his stories, whether it was an entire My World and Welcome to It, was a TV series when I was growing up. There was Thurber. There was the Thurber Carnival that was on my parents' bookshelf. And
he was a cartoonist,
Walter Mitty became a
Walter
national...
Mitty. Walter Mitty, of course, The Secret Life of Walter Mitty. And Liebling was not remembered for a long time. Liebling was kept alive. Liebling died in 1963. He was resurrected in the mid-70s when this alternative journalism publication, More, came into existence, and they had an annual conference, and they quoted Liebling's famous dictum, you know, that the power of the press belongs to those who own one. And I had never heard of Liebling, and then I remember I was so eager. I was in the thrall of the new journalism then, and I wanted whatever to write, you know, the way. I was not at The New Yorker yet, so I was not taught that I was not allowed to admire Tom Wolfe at that point. And we later got around that. But all that kind of new journalism was fantastic. So I had this poster on my office wall of at another publication of Liebling with that Moore conference quote from Liebling, power of the press, and someone came into my office and asked me about Liebling. I had no clue who he was. I was faking it, you know, completely. And then he was revived.
And Gibbs also, I mean, his breadth probably didn't help his you know, enduring reputation.
Well, White had.
He did, but of course, as you say, he had, you know, best-selling children's books. And wrote sentimentally about nature.
White strikes me as more of an essayist, no matter what the subject. He was not a critic. He didn't do profiles. He certainly didn't do parodies. Gibbs certainly had a range. Are you suggesting that he spread himself too thin, perhaps?
I'm not saying only in terms of trying to reverse engineer why isn't he as famous as he ought to be. Given how much good material, as you know better than we do, in this book, I don't think you can make that. I don't think that was a problem in terms of the output, certainly. But
when Gibbs wrote his profile of Alexander Wolcott, he refers to Wolcott describing himself Thurber writes about this, that Wolcott described himself as the best writer in America, but with nothing particular to say. And and Gibbs actually thought that of himself, arguably, that he greatly undervalued himself, I think. And he was an editor. He was apparently a terrific editor, and you can tell it from reading his you know, rules for editing, that he was the one who was great at taking things out. That was where it began with Gibbs, and that's what really good writing is knowing what to leave out rather than what to put in. And but that was consonant with his generally self-effacing being.
He was very self-effacing. He was very unhappy. He was depressed. He was alcoholic. He really did not believe in himself. Unlike Alexander Wolcott, though, he was not self-indulgent. He was not florid. And I dare say that most of the things he wrote about ultimately mattered more than what Wolcott indulged in. Do you think he could have established himself at the New Yorker of today? This is my last question, then we'll get to yours. Would Gibbs have been a bad fit at the contemporary New Yorker?
I don't think so.
No, and there are Gibbsians, of whom Mark is one, certainly writing there now, David Owen, Patty Marks. I could go on. I mean,
Sandy Frazier.
I mean, I don't think so at all. I mean,
no.
There may have been moments in the past when he... No, even then. I mean, I think he'd be fine.
No, I think he was great, and would have been great in any...
Okay, I'm thinking too of his personal behavior. There are many instances of him arriving plastered.
Well,
at
we're
the
talking
theater.
About a different time.
Yeah, I mean, since Kurt left the New Yorker,
exactly.
You know,
starts forced out. Really.
So, no, it was. Everybody was an alcoholic. Then everybody smoked, and everybody was an alcoholic, and everyone had cheesy affairs in the
cheesy.
Office.
And, emphasis on the cheesy.
So
Mark. No.
Okay, I'm sure you're bursting with questions, and we'll take them seriatim. Anyway, yeah, Peter.
I guess is to bring up Tom Wolfe, who in the mid-60s writes a piece for the early New York Magazine, which I think he said was inspired by the Loose piece about William Shawn. It's safe to say the New Yorker didn't respond very well to it. That they didn't, and I guess my question is sort of in terms of like, it related to that, whether Gibbs would be the kind of writer that would be accepted today at the New Yorker. Did they sort of lose a certain sense of humor about how to do parodies? Because that was very much a parody of a certain time, and I think the reaction to it was understandable to a certain extent, but is turnaround fair game in terms of the new journalism and what they were attempting to do and to insert a sense of Gibbsian sensibility in looking at the New Yorker of that period?
If I answer this, let's just see how much trouble I can get in.
It's a loaded question.
You're absolutely right in your premise that those pieces are a lot of fun. The New Yorker, when Tom Wolfe in what was then the Sunday supplement to the New York Herald Tribune, later New York Magazine, as you say, published this two-part profile of William Shawn, the New Yorker basically tried to enjoin publication. I mean, they called Jock Whitney, I think, who owned the Herald Tribune, and tried to
and they
get
got
him to
through to the White House, Richard Goodwin.
Goodwin, yeah.
Goodwin, exactly. Dick Goodwin.
Oh,
Dick
right,
Goodwin.
Right. So they were the New Yorker were just ridiculous, silly in their response to that, but that was part of the cult of William Shawn. William Shawn became the editor upon Harold Roth's death in 1951. And that was, the magazine had already taken a turn, and it was a turn that Gibbs himself was uncomfortable with. He wrote some memo to someone or a letter about...
To Thurber, actually. He said, the magazine is decaying at almost exactly the right rate for me, because he saw himself in decline as well.
He lived for another...
10 years.
8 years.
Eight years. He died in 1958.
But they had published Hiroshima, for example, and...
And that was simply out of step with Gibbs's sort of very satiric sensibility.
Well, and with the magazine, the New Yorker was you know, all pretty much wall to wall irony and wit and humor at the beginning.
It was, and not as funny as it thought it was.
Right.
But
mm-hmm.
then there were mm-hmm. people like Gibbs, like Thurber.
No, it ripened
Frank
into a
Frank Sullivan,
version
Corey
of
Ford.
What?
The humorists, Frank Sullivan, Corey Ford, Parker.
Yeah, no, but the other thing that happened, this is where I can dig a little hole for myself. The New Yorker used to have profiles of people who weren't important. Now, it's obviously fun if you can take a Henry Luce or a Thomas Dewey and deflate that person, and I have done that sort of thing. But you could also, there's less of that now. I mean, it's not discouraged because David Remnick, the editor, is smart. And if he can get those kind of pieces, he wants them. But when people like Gibbs and Liebling were doing what they do, and Bainbridge was another one who did these pieces, it was all barbed and it was fun. And you picked it up and you didn't even know who'd written the piece because the byline was at the bottom and you just got into this great takedown of someone.
It was very spy-esque, frankly.
Spy, right.
There you go.
What happened to that?
It lasted a while. You know, we had its 12 funny years just like the New Yorker did.
Harmon, did you have a question? Yeah. And if I may follow up.
Yes, no, if I was thinking about the recent Columbia Magazine article about Lionel Trilling being forgotten. And I'm wondering if there's a parallel, because, I mean, you can't compare them. Trilling's name is more well known, but apparently what the magazine article was saying briefly was that he's just not read anymore, referred to as much. And he was also, he made criticism an art in a certain sense, or so they say. So I wonder if there's any parallel between Gibbs and Trilling in terms of they're not being remembered or used as much.
You know, it's funny. As when you started asking that question, I said to myself, I have absolutely no answer for this. But then the answer came to me. If he had had, I think, Edmund Wilson's job at The New Yorker, he would have been remembered. If he had had that kind of audience on a regular basis, and Wilson, there's a famous anecdote. In fact, I think it was at the New School. They were in a men's room, and Trilling was trying to complete his book on Matthew Arnold, and he was getting nowhere. No one wanted a book about Matthew Arnold in the 1930s.
Was trying to take a leak.
That's right. That's absolutely right. They were standing trough to trough in the men's room, and everyone was consumed with Marxist politics in the 30s. No one cared about literary criticism, but Edmund Wilson encouraged him. He said he would like to read a book like that. That got Trilling to finish the book. Wilson, of course, though, inherited Clifton Fadiman's job as book critic for the New Yorker, and I think in part because Wilson was a more trenchant critic than Trilling.
Trilling versus Gibbs. Yeah. Trilling was an incredibly famous person in his time in a way that Gibbs never was.
True. I mean, he had the Partisan Review platform among other things, and the whole New York intellectuals on his side.
Yeah.
And Gibbs had children with his third wife. He had a son named Tony, whose real name was Wolcott Jr. And his daughter Janet. Did you know Tony?
I did know Tony.
I'm in close touch.
He's still alive. I mean,
he's doing well. Tony is he's in his mid 70s. He's living in Maine, and he was a New Yorker editor and writer for some years, a very good one. Janet and Tony, Tony's the first to acknowledge this. Did not have a very happy childhood. Both of their parents, Eleanor, their mother, and Wolcott, were desperate alcoholics. I mean, we're talking, Eleanor died when she was smoking in bed and set herself and the apartment on fire. Same thing happened a few times to Gibbs. He always woke up. It didn't help that Janet was manic depressive as well. Very, very, very sad. And Tony ended up taking very close care of her daughter, Susan, who I've met also. She's in California and she's doing well. Tony's fine.
Yeah, Tony struck me. He was very, like a lot of children of alcoholics, I think, he was aggressively normal, almost.
That's well put. It really is. It really is.
And he really, he was very buttoned down.
He's not demonstrative.
Affable. No, not demonstrative in any way.
Although that sort of describes every New Yorker editor I've ever met. Aggressively buttoned down.
Aggressively buttoned
normal
down, yeah, right. Let me think of the exceptions.
Well,
can't.
Of course there are some.
But and what he wrote about, he wrote for the magazine almost exclusively about yachting and boating.
That is absolutely correct. And when I visited him in Maine in 07, the America's Cup was on, and when he wasn't talking to me, he was watching the America's Cup. But he inherited from his father a love of the ocean.
Yeah, well, they lived on Fire Island in the summer, and
that's right.
Where he got that. There's a great anecdote also about Tony's a very small boy, and Gibbs, you know, is getting ready to go to the theater, and he would often wear a dinner jacket and or a black tie, and Tony sees his father on his way out, and he says, you know, he had an assignment in school that he had to, every boy had to come home and had to write about what their fathers did for a living, and he had no idea what his father did. So he asked him as he was on his way out, and he said, and Gibbs said to him, we'll think about it. He said, I work nights, I come back after you're asleep, obviously I'm a burglar. and the kid believed him. Don't explain, don't complain. You know?
And Tony, in his innocence, wrote his essay about right. this, and the headmaster Gibbs called. Got a call from the school the next day. Right. What?
But that was curious. Is that he struck me that way, and that's how he struck you to Tony.
Well, I've been in touch with both Tony and his first wife, Tish. He's very happily married to his third, and he's actually on very good terms with Tish. And she suggested that ever since Janet died, and I'm sorry that I didn't get a chance to speak with her. She died maybe a year or so before I began researching Gibbs. He's been more willing to open up, and I'm frankly very grateful that he has to me. Just very briefly, one of the greatest compliments I ever received was from a mutual friend, and she asked him, well, what do you think about this stranger, Vince Aguirre, writing about your father? And Tony said, his heart's in the right place. I appreciated that he was able to pick up on that. Mm-hmm. I really did. Yes.
Than St. Clair McKelway or Phil Hamburger I don't have to tell you.
You know your personnel, which is good. Well, you know, it's funny. The reason we're sitting here tonight is because my publishers at Bloomsbury came out with McKelway's collected pieces last year. McKelway, for instance, I just did not have that many clues about him scattered through what I had read in The New Yorker. Phil Hamburger, who I think I literally saw in a forum like this once, similarly, Gibbs simply struck me as so prolific a writer, so good a writer, so puzzling and complex a personality, so troubled, yet so funny and mysterious that I was simply determined to tell his story. All of the major figures in The New Yorker seem to me to have been given their due and not Gibbs, and I just found this inexcusable. It's a weird compulsion on my part. As someone said in a blog astutely a few weeks ago, I've been living with this guy in my brain for about 5 years now, and he continues to fascinate me.
Yeah, I was just wondering if there might be a certain lack of political sophistication on the part of Gibbs, or maybe a lack of understanding of the modernist strain in art. In particular, when I heard about his reaction to the Arthur Miller play, he didn't quite get what Miller was up to. And also the reaction to the John Morley play, where he said they were just making it up as they go along. I thought of the John Morley, the film he was in, Faces, with John Cassavetes. That was in 1968, where they definitely did make it up as they go along, you know. And the other thought I had was maybe Gibbs, in the language of this generation, didn't know how to brand himself or market himself, or maybe he was just too much of a generalist and all that. And did he know Updike? Because Updike
in terms of not being enthusiastic about experimental theater. Read the review of Waiting for Godot. Oh. If you want to go, oh, dude.
And he said, never in my experience have I seen such fuss made over such meager moonshine, I believe was his expression.
Nobody's perfect.
Right, exactly.
You mentioned both politics and art. There's going to be an extensive review. It's more of an essay about The New Yorker in general in the Weekly Standard in at least a couple of weeks, maybe a few weeks. And Joseph Epstein, who's done it and was kind enough to show it to me, said that he read the entire book, which is about 700 pages long, And he said he still didn't know what Gibbs's politics were.
I think that piece that Kurt read is Gibbs channeling E.B. White.
The World War II.
The beginning of the war. That he really, most of the stuff that you've put in this collection is much more, I mean, I don't know if the word lighter, it's about less consequential subjects.
I will say.
And White was away. When England entered the war, White had left the New Yorker.
Gibbs had taken over notes and comment from him. It's true. I will tell you, based mainly on my conversations with Tony, that his father, I think his father was fairly liberal, but I think he was one of those equal opportunity haters. He didn't have much use for either political party. He was an atheist, but he had largely the same disregard for Democrats and Republicans. I agree that he did not have much patience for experimental theater, postmodernism. He was a fuddy-duddy in that respect. He could have conceivably opened his mind a bit more, but he simply called it as he saw it. And there have been a couple of dissertations written about Gibbs as theater critic. He liked well-made, well-constructed works, whether they were dramas, comedies, or musicals. You would not expect him to be receptive to certain things, but he was if he thought they made sense to him.
For all of its, you know, sort of the liberalism that it's identified with. Now, the New Yorker was a basically pretty conservative place in terms of aesthetic anything for very...
It had very traditional notions about form and content, I agree.
Right, yeah.
Yes. In front first and then behind you. Yeah.
Yeah, wasn't that basically Lindbergh, America First? Oh, war's going to be so terrible. Let's lower the morale of the folks. I mean, the piece that you did with all those dead that are going to be around there. You know, Hitler had been asking for war. I mean, you know, been oppressing and killing people, you know, quite a bit there up until 1939, 1940. So, I just didn't get any sympathy for that because I've been doing Lindbergh for a while, and I just, there was the echo, which was the majority.
Was he an America Firster? I mean, I wouldn't take September 39 saying this is going to be hellish as evidence of being an isolationist.
He was not an America Firster, but he also wasn't a world government sort of the way that White was. Exactly. No, I think he had a very serious... The New Yorker spent so much of the 30s, frankly, playing around. I mean, it was castigated by The Nation and a number of more left publications for being insufficiently knowledgeable and astute about the Depression, the rise of fascism, and things like that. Harold Ross said, well, that's not our business, but I do think that when war and real world calamity became too obvious to ignore, that the New Yorker swung into action.
That's the watershed in the history of the magazine. Yeah. It's unquestionably the Second World War. And then it just... You know, evolve.
And then there was no going back to the gag mag.
The world, as Kurt said, you know, that was a different time, and everything changed. I mean, I think when Spy came along, people were so thrilled that it wasn't, you know, the National Lampoon was not sophisticated. It was funny,
a little too anarchic. Right,
but you had revived something that people were missing.
The greatest compliment I ever got was when I met William Maxwell, and he told me he liked Spy magazine. He was a New Yorker editor and great writer, and I thought, okay, my work is done.
Yeah. But that was exactly a, you know, there was a specific audience in the culture that didn't even realize exactly what it was missing that the New Yorker had at one point, and that you renewed.
I think we'll take one more if that's all right. And yes.
Yeah, I have one word of compliment and one of complaint. I grew up in a household where Gibbs was not only not ignored, he was lionized. Hobart Weeks was my godfather.
Oh, my goodness.
And my father constantly referred to Wolcott and always meant Gibbs, not Alexander. And my father was constantly saying, cut out the adverbs. Just cut it down. And I believe Gibbs took over the theater column from my grandfather.
Yes, he did.
But... in that vein, I believe he was just a little too kind to a play that my grandfather spent almost 7 years trying to close down and vilify.
And when, even though he did somewhat of a hatchet job, his review of A.B.'s Irish Rose was much too kind.
Well, Nat, do you want to cite that famous footnote that you said at the coffee house a couple of years ago?
Well, Robert Benchley started out reviewing A.B.'s Irish Rose for Life magazine and then had to do weekly one-liners for it. And he would say things like, "Will the Marines never come?" this is still popular, which shows why there are so many shaved necks on the streets. And it went on for 5-6 years and was setting records. And he finally got tired of trying to find new bad things to say about it. At one point, he held a contest for the best bad review of A.B.'s Irish Rose. And Harpo Marx won with a review that said, "It's really no worse than a bad cold." And it went on and on and on and on. And finally, he had nothing else to say. So he went to the oldest source he could think of and went to the Bible. And one week, people opened up Life magazine and saw under A.B.'s Irish Rose, it said, "See Hebrews 13:8. That's all. But if you went and looked, Hebrews 13:8, the entire chapter is, the entire verse, is Jesus Christ the same yesterday and today and forever. Gibbs went on at greater length and was a little kinder to the play, but he was indeed lionized when I grew up by everybody I knew, so I thank you for putting these works together because we've been missing them for years.
Well, thank you, Nat, and everyone for being here, and for what it's worth, when you do purchase your copy at Evening's End, you will find Gibbs's review of A.B.'s Irish Rose, among many other pieces in there. Anything else? Are we all right? Thank you so much. Thank you.